morning. Happy New Year to you. We are so excited about the things that God will be blessing us with here at Hutchinson Missionary Baptist Church for the year of 2022. Welcome to Sunday School. I am Deacon Michael Gibbs, your superintendent. We have a great lesson coming to us this morning from Genesis, the 4th chapter, 1st through the 15th verse. And our subject from our commentary is justice, vengeance, and mercy. And from our Sunday School book, Underserved Mercy. Our key verse this morning is coming from Genesis 4, verse 10. The Lord said, "What hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground." We're blessed to have with us this morning for our lesson review, Minister Queen Green will come and bless us with our lesson review. Again, Happy New Year to you. Let's stay safe. And thank Jesus for bringing us all the way through 21 to 22. At this time, we will hear from Minister Green.
Greetings to all. It is a blessing to greet you this Sunday morning, the first Sunday in January, 2022. Oh, how precious it is to be gifted this new day, a day that we have never seen before and will never see it again. We thank God for his new grace and his new mercy. Undeserved mercy. Our lesson this morning is coming from Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 through 15. It has been broken down with the following titles. Verses 1 through 5 is contrast and reception. Verse 6 and 7 is a divine warning. And verse 8 through 15 is titled Gracious Punishment. And our devotion reading is Psalms 31, verses 9 through 16. Now here we find David pouring out his heart to his Heavenly Father. Because of his distress and frustration, he is telling God how he feels and how he has been treated by the people. He was feeling bad for himself because he felt that he had been ridiculed and forgotten, not only by his enemies, but also his friends. So his life had been overtaken with grief. Because the people was whispering, he said that there was terror on every side. They was conspiring against him and plotting to take his life. But here we can learn a lesson from David. Let David's transparency before God be an example for us. Take these divine inspired prayers and make them your own. David trusted that God had the power to rescue him. He knew that every aspect of his life was in God's hand, and he anticipated God's deliverance. But when we get to our lesson this morning, at this time, Adam and Eve had been removed from the Garden of Eden. They had become parents of the first children, fathered by Adam and birthed by Eve. Their first two children were males. The oldest one named Cain, and the second son was named Abel. As they grew, we noted that each one had a different job description. Cain was a farmer by occupation, and Abel was a shepherd. This shows the importance of children being taught that there is a call to work for everyone. There must have been a time when Cain and Abel was both instructed that a sinful man can only approach the holy God on the grounds of a blood sacrifice. The offerings of Cain and Abram were different. Cain rejected this revelation and came with a bloodless offering of fruit and vegetable, blood nowhere. He showed a proud and unbelieving heart. Therefore, he and his offerings were rejected. Now, Abram came as a sinner, believing the divine decree and offering slain animals. He brought the first fruit of his flock, saying and showing that the Lord deserves the best. His offering expressed humility, sincerity, and a believing of obedience. He came seeking the benefit of the new covenant of mercy. The Lord received Abel's offering. Now, envious of Abel, Cain killed his brother and was cursed by God for the murder. His works was evil, but his brother's works was righteous. Now we can see a parallel here with the blood. The blood of Abel cries out for vengeance, but the blood of Christ speaks for salvation. Now, malice in the heart ended in murder by the hands. Cain slew his younger brother, his own mother's son, whom he should have protected. He should have loved. We can see the pride, the unbelief of Cain when he tried to deny the crime if he could conceal it from the all-knowing God. Here we see murder is a crying sin. Blood calls for blood. The blood of the murdered was calling for the blood of the murderer. Now, God knew the answer when he asked Cain, "Where is thy brother?" Instead, Cain answered, "Am I my brother's keeper?" Was God giving Cain the opportunity to take responsibility for what he had done? Who knows how far a divine curse goes, how far it reaches, or how deep it pierces? Son, like dad, did not take responsibility for what he had done. Therefore, God punished Cain. For Cain, the ground would never yield for him again. Therefore, he was to become a fugitive and restless wanderer on the earth. Not only was Cain cast aside like his father from the garden, but he was removed from the presence of God.
How good the Lord is. We thank God for his spirit. We thank God for being alive and pray God's blessing be upon you. To our pastor of the Hutchinson Missionary Baptist Church, we say good evening. This is the time to set aside that we give honor to where God has called from labor to rest. We pray for those families and we pray God would keep them, for we love them. As our pastor say, we love you and there's nothing you can do about it. Jesus says, "Blessed are them that mourn, for they shall be comforted." There is an old song that says, "Earth has no sorrow, for heaven cannot heal."
Good evening. We also pay tribute to those that God has called from darkness to his marvelous light. They fought a good fight. They kept the faith. Now a crown is laid up in heaven for them. Their legacy will always be archived in our hearts and our souls and our minds. They will never be forgotten. God said in his word that I will never leave you nor forsake you. And that is a promise from God. Thank you.
Hello, this is Pastor Courtney.
And Lady Nisha, and welcome to today's broadcast.
Listen, we want you to get the family together and share here on social media. You are in for a treat. We thank you for joining us today. And remember, we love you, and there is nothing you can do about it. Hutchison Higher.
I know it's all ready. Just believe and receive it all.
Giving is a vital part of our worship, and it supports the continued work of building God's kingdom even in these most difficult times. We give because God has overwhelmingly displayed His love, grace, mercy, peace, protection, opened doors, made our enemies leave us alone, healed our bodies. The list goes on and on. I want you to get in your mind and in your heart something that God has done for you. For we don't do this out of obligation. We don't give and sow and support our church out of obligation because we have to. The real question is, why wouldn't you? When we see how God has blessed not only us individually, but expanded the reach of our church even in pandemic, we are motivated to continue to give that our church can indeed go higher and higher. And I thank you today for your partnership and support in this giving moment. Giving and giving here at Hutchison is convenient and accessible for you. We have several giving options for you. You can mail or drop off your donation to 860 East Grove Street, Montgomery, Alabama, zip 36104. You can fill out an envelope and mail it to us, or you can drop it off during our normal business hours, Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday, between the hours of 9 a.m. and 2 o'clock p.m. Central Standard Time. Through the power of technology, giving is even more convenient and accessible. Download on your Apple or Android device the Givelify app. Search us, Hutchison Missionary Baptist Church, and there you can give to whatever area you desire. You can set up a one-time donation and even set up reoccurring donations. Or you can give via Cash App. Our cash tag is $HutchisonMBC860. Please do not forget that 860, $HutchisonMBC860. Your giving, big or small, becomes much in the hands of God, empowering our hands to be the church without walls. In this pandemic, we've been able to feed hundreds of families through our monthly food giveaway. We've been able to distribute and make available vaccinations to our community. Many ministries have continued to meet and take on various missional projects. We've helped to support and build up the Total Man through our Project Finder initiative, fitness instruction, nutritional education, group reinforcement. And most of all, this worship experience that you're watching today is made possible through your partnership and your giving, your support. And so it's more than just coming on to a broadcast. If you have been blessed and are being blessed, would you be a blessing as we continue to do God's work? Let's go the extra mile in taking our church higher in the giving of our Hutchison Higher Pledge. If you haven't made a pledge, consider making a pledge today. Continue to pay on your pledge. For it is through your pledge that we are able to facilitate those over and above projects. Through your faithfulness and through your generosity, we've been able to repair our roof, to replace our heating and air system, and make needed upgrades to our technology, audio, and video equipment. We are committed to bringing you quality ministry in the pandemic. No, the church is not closed. We've just adapted to this new method of delivery. And with your continued support, God will take us higher and higher and higher. May the Lord bless you just when you need it most, the way you need it most. In the name of our great Jehovah Jireh provider, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask or think, supplying all of your needs according to his riches in glory. And for that, we give him praise, honor, and glory, and we give cheerfully, for we know who is our everything in the midst of all that is going on around us. I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah. Well, praise the Lord, my brothers and my sisters. We are grateful for what I consider a priceless privilege of worshiping together on this, the first Sunday of the new year. And you know how very precious first Sundays are to me and to so many across our worship tradition, in that we remember the sacrifice of our Savior Jesus Christ. On the heels of our celebration of that promising baby boy Jesus, we know that he came, that he grew up, and that he fulfilled his assignment in being the propitiation for our sin, the ultimate lamb slain for the atonement of the sins of all of mankind, past, present, and even future. And that's where we fit in. And we are grateful even more as we are gathered together as a family, because we know if it were not for the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and the shed blood of Jesus Christ, we would not have survived this pandemic. We would not live to have something to rejoice in. And so certainly in our commitment to you, we have not resumed in-person worship, but every month, every first Sunday, we gather together in the taking of Holy Communion, remembering the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And the Bible says that we are to examine ourselves. As you go to get your communion elements, let's be prayerful in this time. And I want you to know that I'm so very grateful for you. Many of you have reached out in overwhelming support, even in the difficulty of this season that we are navigating. And I thank you so very much. And from me and from my family and Lady Nisha and Bishop, amen, we are grateful for you. And as we declare it and we mean it from our hearts, that we love you and there is nothing you can do about it. And that love must be spread amongst each other. I pray for that, that the Lord would bring us together, that he would keep us together as we look to him in prayer. I'm praying for you and your family, and I ask now for the heads of the household to begin to pray. Even if you're by yourself, let's begin to pray the prayer of repentance, the prayer of adoration and gratitude for the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. Supplication that we would receive strength to do his will and continue to live worthy of that sacrifice and the salvation that we receive. So, Father, now we thank you. I give you praise for this first Sunday of the year. I give you praise for the sacrifice and the shed blood of your Son. We're so undeserving of it, but we thank you, Father, for loving us so very much. Jesus Christ, we thank you for paying the ultimate price, giving yourself as the ultimate sacrifice. Thank you for your body which was given, your blood which was shed. And we now ask of forgiveness as we examine ourselves. We cannot go into a new year with the same old ways, with the same old habits, with the same old lifestyle. And now, Lord, we ask that you forgive us. You said if we confess our sin, you're faithful and you're just to forgive us of those sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And we thank you for it right now. We thank you for bringing us together, every household, every family, in that bond of love. We thank you for bringing our church together in that bond of love. Let it flow from heart to heart, from person to person, young and old. We thank you, Father, that your will be done and your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Use us as your vessels that we may work out and walk out, hallelujah, that soul salvation being beacons of light, the salt of the earth, witnesses in these last and evil days. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen. Certainly trust that you have your communion element at this time, wherever you are, as we remember the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible declares that on the night in which he was betrayed, there gathered with his disciples, he took bread. This is something that you cannot do without, but he knew that he represented the bread of life. He took that bread and he blessed it and he broke it. Sometimes we never experience God's greatest of blessings until we are broken. Somebody feels broken right now, but know that in that brokenness, God has a blessedness for you. I'm trusting that for my life and for all of our lives. And he took that bread and he blessed it and said, take, eat. This is my body given for you. Let us eat together. In like manner, he took the cup. Having blessed it, he said, take, drink. It's the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the remission of your sin. Let us drink together. Well, in your house, with your family, you ought to just take a quick moment to give to the Lord praise, honor, and glory. For it is the blood of Jesus that gives us continued strength from day to day. As the hymnologist declared, it reaches to the highest mountain, flows to the lowest valley, gives us strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. And now, as we prepare to receive the word of the Lord, let us once again pray. And I want you to make sure that you've shared today's broadcast. Put it in the comments. I'm ready for the word. I'm ready for the word. I'm ready for the word of the Lord. Father, we thank you that now, as we have remembered your sacrifice, we thank you that you are the word made flesh dwelling among us. And now, as we visit your written word, speak to us in such a way that we may live it out. Speak to us in such a way that we will have strength for the continued journey and challenges of life. We thank you now for standing in my body, thinking through my mind, speaking with my tongue. As I decrease, you increase, that you might be glorified, your people may be edified, and the devil would be horrified. In Jesus' name, and together we said, amen. I want to talk to you this morning from the gospel as recorded here in Luke. And as we go here into Luke, the 22nd chapter, beginning at the 39th verse. Luke 22, beginning at the 39th verse, it declares, coming out, he went to the mountain of Olives, as he was accustomed, and his disciples also followed him. When he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed and said, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. When he arose from prayer and had come to his disciples, he found them sleeping from sorrow. Then he said to them, "Why do you sleep? Rise and pray, lest you enter into temptation." I want to talk this morning, and I want to really deal with this entire month, the resolution. The resolution. It is at this point, every year around this time, we find ourselves setting goals, aims for achievement, objectives, and making vision boards, constructing vision and mission statements, cutting out pictures from magazines, dreaming and dreaming big. We call them New Year's resolutions. Certainly at the point of the beginning of the year, it is a resolution that, if not kept, by the end of the year becomes a resolution. It is a moment where everyone must first evaluate, even our church, your business, every facet and area of your life is due for an evaluation, deserves an evaluation. For only through evaluation can we move with transformation from a place of resolution. Resolution is powerful because it is indicative of a made-up mind. It is a clarity of mind. It is a determination and aspiration that begins in the mind, engages your members, your faculties, the energies of your body to create a reality that starts as simply a dream or resolution. Everybody ought to be working towards being their best self. Not just a better self, but their best self. Each of us must truly aspire to go higher, that the Lord would plant their feet on solid ground, that they would be and do all that God has called of them to be and to do. And in our pursuit of that, we refer to our greatest aim, role model, one who exemplifies what it is to move with a made-up mind, what it is to truly have resolution. As we just shared in Holy Communion, the timeline of our Savior's agony is that he moves from that table, that communion table. That is why we took communion before the message on today. But as he moves from that communion table with his disciples, he faces the reality of his assignment. He has to have resolution concerning his assignment. So should we. He's there at his table with his disciples, but he knows that now he must move from that table upon the table of sacrifice, That is the true essence of his assignment. Not just healing the sick, not just raising the dead, not just opening blinded eyes, not only teaching in parables, but the truth of his assignment was to shed his blood, was to give the totality of his purpose to preserve man, to reconcile man, to save and to restore man. Have you discovered your purpose? At the beginning of every year, you ought to seek clarity on your assignment. That's what I've had to do. That's what I've had to do in my life, to seek God. Lord, what would you have me to do in this season? I pray that is your prayer. Jesus had clarity and understanding concerning his assignment. He knew that as an extension of his assignment, healings took place. Miraculous events and occurrences took place. Because yes, as the prophet Isaiah declared, he would be wonderful, filled with miracles, signs, and wonders. But the ultimate wonder would take place when he would die, be buried, and resurrected from the dead. He struggles, however, with that assignment. Assignments are easier said than done. Many people live their entire lives doing stuff, but never discovering their assignment. What is your assignment? A charge to keep we have, a God to glorify, to serve this present age, our calling to fulfill. I remember discovering my assignment at a very early age. Boy Wonder, as I was called, standing there before People's Baptist Church, delivering my initial sermon almost 22 years ago. I had a clear understanding of my purpose to preach and to proclaim, to be a messenger of God in the earth. Now, when you understand your assignment, you spend the rest of your life coming into more understanding. Because though that is always the core of my assignment, it looks different in different seasons. When I initially started, I was evangelistic primarily in nature, going from different church to different church. And then at the age of 18, God moved me into pastoral ministry. Of course, I served at First Missionary Baptist and now serving here at Hutchison, shifting and believing God to continue to guide me with clarity in what that assignment looks like in every season. Why are you saying that, Pastor? Because even when you look at Jesus's life, Jesus did not just be born and then move immediately into dying and being buried and resurrected. At this time, Jesus is 33 years old. And in periods and seasons of his life, he is fulfilling that ultimate assignment. For the first 12 years of his life, and even into the 18 years of his life, he is growing, he is maturing, he is being about his natural father's business, and then he shifts at age 30 into his heavenly father's business. You see those shifts? Yes, from 30 to 33, he is doing the miraculous business. He is teaching and explaining the concepts and mysteries of God that man would understand. But now at 33, he is in a distinct season of his life where he now has to fulfill the ultimate of that assignment. Even after he was resurrected, he ascended into the heavens, and the Bible says that he ever lived to make intercession for us. Jesus is still completing his assignment. The Bible says that one day he will come back. He will come back. That will be a distinct assignment to crack that sky, to descend, to come again, and to now subdue all things. We understand that eschatologically, that every knee shall one day bow and tongue confess that he is Lord over all, that all things will become subject to him, and then he will lay all things back at the feet of his Father. And so the assignment in every season looks different, but specific to this season, he's about to mount that cross. And there's a certain distress and agony that accompanies this divine assignment. Are y'all following me today? He is resolved concerning the divine assignment, but he has to wrestle with the distress and agony that is associated with that assignment. All of us will have seasons of distress and of agony. Did you hear that? That's why I told you the other day to count it all joy when you fall into diverse trials and temptations. Distress and agony will accompany that assignment. Certainly Jesus has had his share of distress and agony. He has to endure one at the very communion table who would betray him, one who would deny him, disciples that would desert him, and now having to go through the process of death, burial, and resurrection. Oh, yes. We think about, as recipients of the finished work of Jesus Christ, how there is ultimate benefit for all of mankind. But no one considers the distress and agony of living out that assignment. You know, when you are truly anointed by God, we sometimes make it look easy. We make it look easy to preach the gospel, to pastor God's people, to balance all of these things, to do what you do as a manager, as a parent, as a husband, as a wife, all the things that you do when God's grace and anointing is upon you, it makes it look easy, but no one knows the private. This is a private moment of Jesus Christ in what is known as the Garden of Gethsemane. The Garden of Gethsemane. It was the first Adam that was given the assignment to be fruitful, to multiply, to replenish the earth, to subdue it in the Garden of Eden. And you know that it is in that garden that sin enters into the world. It is now the second Adam, Jesus Christ, who is wrestling with having, watch this, to pay for somebody else's mistakes. He has to pay through the Garden of Gethsemane what Adam and Eve got wrong in the Garden of Eden. Yet it's a necessary affliction. It's a necessary trial and tribulation. Though it is necessary, as I told you, watch night, it is only temporary. But going through the distress and agony, it feels like forever. It feels like forever that you have to bear it. But I'm so glad today that trouble does not last always. Glory to God. I think somebody ought to give the Lord praise, glory, and honor, because though we cannot promise a trouble-free year, hallelujah, we know that the distress and agony will not last always. But let's look a little more. The distress and agony, watch this, it is It is so heavy upon him, draining upon him. Look at it, that his sweat became as blood. It is not only a spiritual struggle, but it is a mental struggle. It engages the systems of his body that, because of the spiritual struggle and the mental and emotional struggle, there's a physical response in the body. See, people don't see how connected they are. Mind, body, and soul. That's why we say Project Finer. Because we have to minister to the total man. Because the assignment, though it is spiritual, it has mental and emotional and even physical effects. Distress and great anguish. I know what that feels like. And some of you know what it feels like too. But the Bible says, hallelujah, the Bible says that Jesus the Christ solicits, watch this, divine assistance. He does it through prayer. Notice that as he is struggling through it, he resolves that this cannot be done in my own strength and in my own might. Talk not just about what you're going to do this year, but talk about the partnership of you and God. And that partnership requires that somebody submits, that somebody yields, that it's not just about a resolution that I conjure up to keep up with the Joneses, to have this air of perfection or success. There is no success until your plans have become subject to the assignment and purpose of God for your life. And that resolution is not my will, but thy will be done. Notice he's praying. He has partners, but he knows that his partners cannot fulfill his assignment for him. They have to fulfill their own. Yes, must Jesus bear this cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone. There's a cross for you and for me. Jesus understands that he has to bear this burden. He has partners that sometimes go to sleep on him. Sometimes our partners in humanity, our partners in living, do not understand the great gravity and weight of being you, of fulfilling God's assignment for you. Yet you must press on, obey God, and fulfill that assignment. Jesus does that. He teaches us how to do that. And in his prayer, he says, not my will. If it be your will, let this cup pass. Nothing wrong with praying for what you desire, but ultimately, he yields. He yields to God and therefore becomes a recipient. The Bible says when he prayed that prayer, angels came and strengthened him. And in the name of Jesus, I pray over your life a dispensing of angelic assistance, that you would understand that though you may feel alone in the carrying out of that assignment, that you would sense angels, protecting angels. Yeah, the Bible says that there are warring angels, angels that'll fight on your behalf. You remember when Elijah was fulfilling the assignment of God, that the army of Syria surrounded him, and his servant thought that this was the end. And he said, Lord, open his eyes that he may see. And he saw chariots of angels surrounding the army of Syria. There are more for you than there are against you. And I'm not talking about simply in the natural. I'm talking about angelic assistance, warring angels. But you also know that there are messenger angels like Gabriel that came to announce the birth of Jesus Christ to Mary and even spoke to Joseph in the dream. May God's word continue to be rehearsed in your spirit, that when you want to go off of what they, he, she, or they are saying, or what you say even to yourself, that you'll have to become subject and be reminded of thus says the word of the Lord. But then there are ministering angels, angels that administer the strength of God, that lift you up, that hold you up. And I'm declaring over your life, in fact, lift your hands wherever you are and declare it. I receive my angel. Glory to God. I receive my strength that I may live a resolved life. And when Jesus got up, he got up in the strength of God, moving in a resolve of mind. He knew that he was not alone, and he could declare in the face of betrayal, bring it on. In the face of denial, bring it on. In the face of folk lying and talking about him and scandalizing his name, bring it on. In the face of nails in his hands and in his feet, bring it on. Crown of thorns on his head, bring it on. Death, hell, and the grave, bring it on, because I know that's not the end of my story. Remember, God has seasons in your life, and I'm believing that as you endure this season, that the next season will be that of victorious, will be that of resurrection, of restoration, of revival. But you got to trust him and be resolved to trust him. Be resolved to endure the process. He endured the cross, despised the shame, and is now seated at the right hand of the throne of God. That is Jesus' story that will become ours. So be not dismayed, whatever may be the time. This is my resolve. God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide. God will take care of you through every day along the way. God will take care of you. And I don't have an organ today, but I think I ought to ask you one question on this first Sunday of this brand new year. Won't he do it? When you reflect over 2021, 2020, and all of your life's journey, the conclusion ought to be, yes, he will. He'll make a way out of no way. He'll open doors. He'll dry your tears. He will order your steps, your stops, and sustain you in every season. That's the God I'm trusting in, and I invite you to trust him on today and every day and live a resolved life. Not my will, but thy will be done. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and remember, I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Okay, so you want this year to be different. Well, at least better than last year. You want to eat better, exercise better, have better relationships. You want to finally take control of your life, and you're going to make resolutions to do just that. But I say, there's only one resolution you should make. Resolve to just give up. Oh yeah, I said it. Just give up. Give up trying to keep up. Give up trying to fit in. Just give up control. Realize today that you are not God. Turn your life over to his care. Pray only for the knowledge of his will. Be guided by his word. Making this year better isn't about finally getting control of your life. It's about recognizing that your attempts at control are what caused all the problems in the first place. And today is your chance to finally just give up and give it all to God.
Well, I pray that you have been tremendously blessed by today's worship experience. And indeed, we have gone higher. But before we sign off, I want to extend an opportunity, especially after hearing the word of God,
for you to receive Christ into your life. The greatest decision you could ever make is making Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. And you don't have to go through hoops. You don't have to leap over walls. It doesn't take all of that extra stuff. Right here, right now. If you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, would you pray this prayer with me? Father, I come to you now. I admit I am a sinner in need of your salvation. I believe, according to Scripture, you sent your Son Jesus, that he died for me and he rose that I may have a brand new life. I turn away from my old way of living and I embrace my new life in Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. My past is behind me. My future is ahead of me. The best is yet to come. If you prayed that prayer with me for the first time, I need you to let us know. Shoot us an email, hmbcprayer@gmail.com. Again, hmbcprayer@gmail.com. Let us know that you have been saved or that you desire membership. We would love for you to connect with us. And you don't have to be in the city of Montgomery or even the state of Alabama. You're welcome to become a part of our virtual membership. We are grateful today that God has connected you to this experience. And we want you to stay connected with us here on Facebook. Make sure that you follow us. And here on YouTube, be sure that you subscribe, that you may receive notifications of future broadcasts. Connect with us each and every single day in our takeoff prayer call. The number is on the screen for you. Join with the community from around the Hutchinson family, Montgomery community, and various cities and states across this country as we begin our day. That's 7 days a week at 7 o'clock a.m. Central Standard Time, 15 minutes of the word and prayer. Your life will never be the same. Join us on Wednesdays for Wednesday in the Word. We're in a special series and you don't want to miss it. Connect with a Sunday school group by calling us, letting us know that you desire to connect, or you can email us at office@hutchinsonmbc.org. And we'll connect you with a Sunday school group that you may continue to grow in your walk with God. And most of all, if you've been blessed by this worship experience, again, share in giving with us. Whether you mail it to 860 East Grove Street, Montgomery, Alabama, 36104, or drop it off during our convenient hours, Tuesday through Thursday, 9 a.m. to 2 o'clock p.m., or whether you give through Givelify, searching us at Hutchinson Missionary Baptist Church, setting up a one-time or reoccurring donations, or even through Cash App, $HutchinsonMBC860. We thank you that you have been a part of a life-changing worship experience. And I believe that as God has ordered your steps to connect with us today, we will stay connected in this journey and God will continue to take us all higher to his glory and honor. Have a great week, a wonderful rest of your day, and remember, I love you and there is nothing you can do about it. We'll see you next week.